Pakistan. So initially I was given empty room like this as no facility to even prepare particles, and my students were sweating like me. So one day they found that the paper which they are touching, because they were playing with gold as well, so that become there. So that shows that something in our sweat is basically reducing gold to gold nanoparticles. So then what we did, because it is just mixture of so many things, we tried to figure out what exactly is the chemical which is responsible for the conversion of those gold ions to gold nanoparticles. And we found that that is biosurfactant, which is common, which is very abundant in our body. And then we made bio-ink. Using that biosurfactant, we developed bio-ink to print these text patterns and circuit patterns of different substrates, plastic and other materials. So initially these were not visible, but you can produce more nanoparticles specifically on those printing, which was done by inkjet printing. And you can develop these type of things. So we actually were targeting that we may be able to develop some flexible electronic materials. But unfortunately in this case, when we observed in the electron microscope, still there was a huge gap between particles, so they were not conductive in nature. So we are still trying to make these kind of things conductive so that they can be used for that. We are working a lot on developing materials that can be used for the detection of different pollutants and simultaneous removal as well. Here is just an example in which we developed these hierarchically porous beads of polymers, they have bigger pores, and within these bigger pores there are very small pores, and out to this there are silver nanoparticles. So they have huge surface area, and then they can be used to develop filters which can basically remove variety of pollutants and even kill bacteria if you pass those kind of water samples around this. So we are also working with some industry, textile industry and actually paint industry, to develop antimicrobial materials as well. This is just an example of antimicrobial paints. So we take the resins which are produced by our local industry, and without using any additional chemicals, starting from commercial silver, you can produce silver nanoparticles. And this plan does simply show that we are increasing the concentration of silver nanoparticles as we go. So we are able to control this. And they can be painted in hospitals so that bacteria cannot contaminate different substances. So this was all about biomedical. I don't know how much time is there, how much injustice there. I am still the halfway. The rest is about energy. So if you want to finish, me to finish here, I can. Should I continue?
It's your permission.
No. You know, like the thing is this, that this is more interesting.
Okay.
You should have started.
Carry on.
Okay. Because my topic was actually biomedical.
Yeah.
So I wanted to finish this, include this as well. So we know that there's a lot of trend about renewable technologies as well, but this is just a trend. In Pakistan, even we are not using renewable energy at all. So if we simply look at the energy that is available from the sun, that is actually the sole source of energy. And if you can harvest this energy, we can actually easily address the energy problems of all the world, basically. So this is just, you can see these dark spots in some regions. If you can install solar cells only in these regions which are rich in sunlight, you can produce about 18 terawatt of energy. And that energy is more than sufficient. At the moment we are using 16 terawatt for the whole world. So this very small amount that you can harvest, then you can actually address all needs of energy technologies. But the problem is, we cannot really harvest all the energy that at the moment that is coming from the sun. So for that, basically, if you look at Pakistan perspective, for example, in Pakistan, if annual growth rate is 8%, by 2030, maybe we will be having this much energy demand. And there is huge gap between energy supply and energy demand. And it is increasing day by day. Despite that, this region is really one of the best regions to harvest sunlight. But for harvesting sunlight, this is currently the energy mix here in Pakistan. So if you look, we can hardly see any contribution from renewable energy technologies. So there is the best source that we are using is still the fuels, the fossil fuels, a lot of environmental pollution. So in order to harvest this energy, basically, you need to develop materials which can absorb sunlight, and then they can convert that light into electrical energy. And for that, different type of solar cell technologies are being developed. Currently, perovskite solar cells, dye-sensitized solar cells, thin-film solar cells, multi-junctional solar cells, a lot of things are being developed. But still, these are the main challenges. One, low efficiency, a high cost of the materials that we are using, because even for the solar cells that we use, here we use crystalline silicon, which is very expensive. And then energy storage. So at daytime we can harvest light, but what about night? What will you do? So you need to develop materials which can store energy as well. Okay, so for that purpose, dye sensitized solar cells, for example, people are trying to develop these kind of dyes which can absorb major portion of sunlight. And this is at the moment the best dye, ruthenium based dye, which is used for this purpose. Ruthenium, we know it is rare earth metal, it's very expensive. And same time, because it is kind of complex, organometallic complex, after some times it degrades as well, if it keeps interacting with the sunlight. So that is the major problem with these dye sensitized solar cells. Back in 2009, so this is work from, I was talking with Shimone about Stilaci. So this guy was professor at MIT. In 2009, they predicted that if they can reduce the size of silver nanoparticle to only 25 atoms, that would be around 1 to 2 nanometer, then that silver will not behave as matter, but it will start behaving as semiconductor. Because the HOMO, LUMO and valence conduction band will be separated, and it will meanwhile absorb major portion of sunlight as well. So they were really curious to prepare these type of silver nano particles of 25 atoms, which has potential applications for solar cell technology. They actually did this. They actually prepared this material using these kind of organic molecules at the surface. Again, when we talk about smaller particles, we always need to use these molecules which can control the nucleation and growth at the early stage, and they are thorough groups. So they were able to actually produce these kind of nanoclusters, but unfortunately they were not very stable. Even after a few hours, they lose their optical properties, so they are of no use for practical applications. So luckily, I was visiting this group back in 2010 and 11, and they gave me this problem that if you can address that, would be great. I came back to Pakistan, and I put one of my undergraduate students to address this challenge. And we were able to design these kind of organic ligands which can produce these silver 44 clusters basically, and they were extremely stable. So you can produce large amount of these clusters. So in nanotechnology, this is very large amount. So this is 1 liter bottle of nanoparticles, large amount. We call it large scale preparation. And then they are stable. You can dry them, and you can then use them whenever you want to. But still the problem is they are soluble in water. For solar cell technology, you need to make soluble in certain solvent which are going to make some thin films. So what is a bad solvent for that? So now we are trying to actually design new ligands which can make equally stable clusters of silver which can absorb a major portion of sunlight and then meanwhile act as a semiconductor to generate that electron hole wave as well. So by making very thin film of silver, that hopefully can be used. So meanwhile, we were also trying to develop many new ligands, polymer-based ligands, which basically have these thiol functional groups. One polymer molecule having several thiol groups. The purpose was to basically arrest the growth of, to stop the growth of these nanoparticle antibodies at this stage. And in this way, we were able to make nanoclusters which were less than 1 nanometer of all these metals. And you will see they are fluorescent. So they are not metals in this size regime. Normally, we know gold, silver, palladium, platinum, all these are metals. But they are metals only when the particle size is bigger than 2 nanometers. Jab 2 nanometers se kam size karte hain, then their valence band and the conduction band, they get separated from each other. And they start behaving like semiconductors and even like molecules. So they become fluorescent and they have really very interesting, they have huge surface area, very active catalyst, and meanwhile can also be used for bioimaging applications because they are fluorescent, they do not photobleach. So a lot of biomedical and energy applications. So at the moment, nowadays, my group is focusing more because all these particles that I have talked so far, they are based on gold and silver, they are very expensive particles. But if you really want to bring this technology to market, you need to work with materials which are cheaper. So for that purpose, we are working nowadays on nanoparticles of iron oxide, nanoparticles of nickel, of copper, of cobalt, which are really abundant. And then use those to separate water to produce hydrogen. Water separated. We know, principally, water can be separated to produce hydrogen. But the amount of energy that is required to separate water, that is more